class, and today I will be talking about class axioms and property types in OWL. In previous web lecture about RDFS, we discussed that we want to classify things in the world around us or in a certain domain. For example, cities and people, and we have this overview of cities and countries, people, so we group them together and we classify something as a city or a house, country, a gender or some role. And in RDFS we can do some classification, but RDF schema is a bit restrictive. And in OWL we can classify the things in the world or in a domain more precise. So we have more rules for this, so we can give a better description of the world around us and also have more advanced inferencing. So I'll talk about the basics of this in the lecture. During the lecture about RDFS, we discuss triple notation to specify all kinds of rules. But for OWL, we now have a nice interface, Protégé. So it's nice, but it's also challenging. But if you you become a bit more proficient in this, it really helps you to specify all these OWL rules and see clearly what is going on. So let's start with classes in OWL. So OWL classes are, they all start from OWL thing. So every class is a subclass of OWL thing. And this is done for checking consistency or inconsistency. So again, an inferencing engine is applied over OWL, and then we need OWL thing to have the superclass of all things. And there is also OWL nothing, which is also used for consistency checking. No class is a subclass of OWL nothing, so we try to check whether this is the case, check for consistency. So this is a short overview of OWL thing and OWL nothing. No individuals are also every individual is of type OWL thing and of OWL named individual, as you can see here. And then no individual and no class belongs to OWL nothing. So using OWL, we can have descriptions of classes, class axioms, which allows us to infer things about classes, to reason over classes, to very precisely specify them. For example, an equivalent class is a class that is basically it contains the same individuals. So the description might be, it might have a different name, but the individuals always belong to both these classes. And you see this this Venn diagram. So you have a Venn diagram of class A with an instance A inside, and of class B with instance B. And then with the equivalent class, we basically say if A is equivalent to B, then its instances also belong to both these classes. So first we specify that A is of type A, B is of type B, and then if we run the reasoner, we'll also infer that A is of is an instance of class B next to an instance of class A. So this is explicit knowledge, which we have triples in some file or in a triple store, and then if we run the reasoner, because we specify that A and B are equivalent, then also instances belonging to A will now also be inferred to belong to class B, and B instances of B to class A. So you see the notation here is a lowercase is an instance, and then an uppercase is a class name. And then next to equivalent class, we can also say complement classes. So if B is a complement of A, then B will not belong in A. So in this case, we say that because B is a complement of A, and we do not assign B yet to any class, we just say B is of the superclass all thing. So it is something, but we do not yet specify to which class it belongs. Then if we run the reasoner, we infer that it is of type B. So everything that's not explicitly specified as belonging to class A will then go to its complement, which we defined as class B. So this is then inferred if you run the reasoner. And well, this might not seem very useful, but then if you have new data that is not yet classified, and you basically want to classify it using these R rules, these class axioms, we could say that if we recognize everything that is of type A, so we assign new data, new individuals, we say this is an instance of class A, and then because of the rule that B is a complement of A, everything else that's not yet classified will automatically be inferred to belong to class B. So this is useful in an application in which you get new data or you have some new research data, and then you want to classify it according to your ontology, and then we can use these rules to have automated inferencing of where a certain class belongs or does not belong. Similarly, we can say that two classes, instead of having the same individuals, we say they never contain the same individuals. So we specify this using the all disjoint with predicate. We say everything of class A is disjoint with class B. And then if we have an instance A belong to class A and instance B belong to both class A and B, you see here in the intersection in this Venn diagram, then the reasoner will say that this is inconsistent, so there is an error according to your domain specification, to your class definition, so the instances are assigned to wrong classes. B is wrongly assigned to class A because A and B are disjoint. For example, a human and a car are never the same. So if you say a Ferrari is of type car and of type human, then the reasoner will say that this is inconsistent. So this is something that that allows you to prevent mistakes during classification. And also it allows you to infer that individuals are different. So complement is a bit similar to disjointness. So in complement, we already discussed that we say everything that is not explicitly assigned to A must be of B. And then with disjoint, we say A and B cannot be the same. So for example, in disjoint, if we say that A, class A and B are disjoint, the reasoner will also infer that instance A and B are different from each other. So they, because of the disjoint declaration, this becomes very explicit. And later we'll also have class axioms in from which we can infer that two things are the same. So next to disjoint, we also have the ability to declare that two classes are that one class is the union of two others. So we say C is a union of A and B, and then if instances A and B belong to class A and B, then we can infer that because they belong to both classes, they also belong to the union of those two classes, namely C. So A and B, by the reason, are then also assigned to class. So an example of a union is that you have a class students and a class teachers. So in this Venn diagram, A and B. And then we say that every instance of either class student or union belongs to a new class academia. So then the student will also be classified as an instance of academia, and the teacher will be classified as an instance of academia. So C, we define this to create a new class C to which automatically instances are assigned to. And similarly with disjointness, we can still specify a new class, saying that two classes, even though they're disjoint, together they can form a new meaningful class of things. So in this example, we have class male and class female, and they together they form a disjoint union to create a new class sex, because male and female denote sex as an as an activity or an orientation. But then again, this is something that you have to model carefully, because nowadays it's debatable how you do gender classification. And then we had the union of class to say if something belongs to A or B, or A and B, then it belongs to a new class. And next to a union of, we can also define a new class that's an intersection of two existing classes. So in this example, we say C is an intersection of B and A. So instances that belong to both class A and B, they will be inferred to also belong to class C. So to give you an example, this could be there could be an intersection of class male and president, and all instances that are both male and president will then be classified to a new class called male president, or a new class spork is the intersection of a spoon and a fork. So if something is both a spoon and a fork, then the reasoner will infer that it also belongs to class spork. And this is useful because if we have some new knowledge that is already classified, we get some new knowledge in an application, and we know it's already classified as a male or a president, then we can automatically assign it to the class male president. So this is useful for also ontology alignment. If you have two ontologies with instances that are classified different, but we can say that even though these instances are classified different, if we know that they belong to some class A and some class B, then they must also belong to a new class C in your new ontology, for example, or your extended ontology. And then there is a nice shorthand for also assigning class membership by just saying that the class A is one, the instances are one of instance A1, A2, and A3. So then if we say, if we know that A1 is of type thing, so it's not yet classified as a specific class, then we know that because of the definition all one off, that it belongs to class A. So the reasoner will infer this. So it's just a different way of writing that A1 is of type class A. We just say class A contains A1. So this is a different notation. All right, so with this we can already classify a lot of things based on the current class they belong to or do not belong to. But we can also infer class membership and give a lot of meaningful statements about our domain using property types. So with property types, we say that a property has a certain characteristic, and from these characteristics we can derive new, infer new knowledge and make our existing knowledge more meaningful. So we have different types of property types. Basically, properties, we have rules for object properties, which connect two objects to each other. And then data type properties are about literals, about the value of literals, values in data. So remember that we can have a name as a literal or an ID or some integer, and then these are our data type properties, and object properties, they are about instances, connecting instances of or class instances basically. And we do not have property restrictions for annotations. So RDFS for labels, for example. So things that contain meta information about your ontology. So properties that describe your ontology instead of describing the actual domain. And we cannot, so a property type can only be about one of these, or two basically, about it. So they can either be a data type property or an object property. So to start with property types, the most intuitive one is symmetric properties. So you say that the property always holds in both directions. So if there is a relation P between x and y, from x to y, then it must also hold in the opposite direction. So you can see that if we say that P is a symmetric property, it goes from x to y, then the reasoner will infer that it also goes from y to x. And an example is marry two. So this is always a bidirectional contract. If somebody is married to another person, that other person is also married to the initial person. So this must hold in both directions. So you can also say the opposite, that a property does not never hold in both directions. And then we say that if you say the property goes from x to y, then having the same property from y to x, you get an inconsistency. So x goes to p, then x has property p to y, then y cannot have the same property in the reverse direction. So as an example, if you have a mother y, then your mother y cannot also have you as a mother. And then if we do say this, that you have a mother y and your mother also has you as her mother, and then the reasoner will infer that the mother of your mother is different from you. So because the property cannot hold between cannot hold in both directions, then one of the two relationships must mean that you are somebody else that is being claimed. So then there is a nice other property that you can specify that basically says that the property is transitive, so it propagates over itself. So you have some property originating from X to Y, and then from Y to Z, then we infer that this property also holds between X and Z. So this is also one of the one rule in propositional logic. If you have something that is transitive, then you can infer that if something originates from goes from X to Y and from Y to Z, then it also goes from X to Z. So as an example, we can have the Partoff relationship. If for example a door handle is part of a car door, and then this car door is part of a car, and then that means that the door handle is also part of the car. So by transitivity, because it belongs to the door and the door belongs to the car, then the door handle also belongs to the car. So then a reasoner will infer that that the door handle belongs to the car. So another very useful property declaration is saying that something is a functional property. And with this, we specify that a property has only one value for any particular instance, or we could say that an instance may only use this property once. So in this this drawing, we show that instance X has this functional property to Y, and it also has a functional property to Z, the same functional property. And in that case, we derive that X and Z, they must be the same. So as an example, has mother is a functional property, because you can only have one mother. So in case we say that you have some mother Y and some mother Z, then the reasoner will infer that Y and Z, these mothers, they must be the same mother. So before, with asymmetric properties, we say that Y and Z must be different. So to say that there is some inconsistency, because we misuse a property declaration. But in this case, we say because a property is functional and can only be used once, and if it's then used twice, then it must refer to the same instance. So similar to the functional property, there is also the inverse functional property, to say that the value of a property will uniquely identify an instance. So as an example, we could say that property ISBN is inverse functional because it uniquely identifies a book. So we say, for example, a book called an instance that instance of class book with the title Primary Semantic Web, having property ISBN 1234, will be the same as a book called the SemWeb Primer, which has the same ISBN. So basically, we can derive that these two instances are the same because they have the same ISBN property. Or we could, another example is that we could derive that a euro note, like a 10 euro note, is the same because it has a unique serial number. So then if we have two instances denoting this euro, this 10 euro, we can identify it as being the same instance because of its serial number. So this is also what is being derived. So in our book example, We might have some data from Amazon.com and some data from Bol.com or the Book Repository. And they have a slightly different title, maybe with a comma or some uppercase and lowercase. But then if we know that the Amazon entry and the Book Depository entry, they both have the same ISBN, then we know that they are actually about the same thing. So they are all both about the Semantic Web Department book. So another property declaration that is more used for reasoning is that is the reflexive property, in which you can say that every individual is always related to itself by a certain property. So as an well, the example here is part of. So a car is always part of itself, or you are always part of yourself. Or more meaningful is maybe to say that you are always a relative of yourself. So then if you want to get the list of all relatives to you, then you will also get yourself. Or maybe even more meaningful, the property knows is reflective. You could say it's reflective because you know yourself, you have seen yourself in the mirror. But you also know other people. So then if you get a list of all the you do a Sparkle query, you say some subject or you as an instance knows, and then question mark object, then you also get yourself retrieved and all the other people you know, or has relation. So you have a relationship with yourself and you have a relationship with your family, for example. So this can be meaningful and useful. And similar to reflexive, we also have irreflexive properties. So this is something restrictive to say that no individual is never related to itself by a certain property. So in the example here is that nobody is the mother of him or herself. And then when there is some, when we say P is irreflexive and some instance has this irreflexive property assigned to itself, we say that this one instance must be different from the other instance, or these are two different instances. So we again derive some inconsistency, and then we say, well, you must it must be the case that X and X are different from each other. So instead of saying that a property is never assigned to is never reflexive, we can so we instead of having these restrictions, we can also infer new knowledge using property declarations. So we can say that some property has an inverse, or some property is an inverse of another property. So we have, for example, the property parent of. So if X is a parent of Y, then Y must be a child of X. And this is something that is again inferred from the reasoner. So this saves having to do, so this saves a lot of time. Otherwise you have to manually specify all Y's as being child of X, all instances that have some parents, to write down that they are just the child of that parent. And then we can also infer properties by saying that if a property holds in a certain direction, then another property must also hold in that direction. So here you have the example that if X has some child Y, then we can also say that the relationship X child Y holds. So X has some child Y. So a different name for the same property. Maybe a more meaningful example is that if X is a student at some university, then we can say that equivalent to student at is enrolled at some university. So if a student is a student at the university, then the student is also enrolled at the university, and then the student also takes classes at the university. So then we derive this second property because it co-occurs. So you see, if the property holds from X to Y, then another property, the equivalent property, also holds from X to Y. In the opposite, instead of saying that something is an equivalent property, we can say that something is a disjunct property. So has parent never co-occurs with has child to the same instance. So if somebody has a child Y, then that child cannot be its parent. So it cannot have the child as a parent, basically. And then we derive inconsistency. If we do declare that some property holds between X and Y, and if the disjunct property also holds between X and Y, then because the disjunct property and the other property are declared together, the reasoner will throw an inconsistency. A very nice property axiom is saying that a property propagates as a chain over other properties. So we again derive new properties by saying that if property Q holds between X and Y, and property R holds between Y and Z, so with Y as the connecting property in the middle, then we derive new property P. So this is similar to, or this is basically a transitivity. So we say that if someone has a parent Y, and that Y has a mother Z, then X has as a grandmother Z, because so your parent has a mother. That must mean that your parent's mother is your grandmother, and we can then derive this. The reasoner will then derive this. So it is similar to the transitive property part of, but here we specify two distinct properties. So we say we denote this using, for example, in turtle we use brackets. So we say Q, property Q and property R, they together form a property chain axiom P. So the P is the new property that will be derived. So in the example, has grandmother is a property chain axiom of has parent and has mother. So we have discussed a lot of class axioms and property axioms, and they're also more formally described in as Aul and Tailman rules. So recall that we had a similar list of Entailment rules for RDF, and they basically say the same thing that we just discussed in the slides. So here you have rule number one, which says that if V is the same as W, then W must be the same as V. So it's bidirectional, same as bidirectional. And then we also say that same as is transitive, because if U is the same as V and V is the same as W, then U and W are the same. And then in rule three, we say basically the same. We again use the same as derivation to have a transitive same as for deriving relationships. So here we say the same as is transitive in terms of classes. So U is the same as W because the same as is transitive. And here we say that if V is the same as W, then and if V has some relationship to O, then because V is the same as W, must also have this relationship to O, because W and V are the same instance. In rule number 4, we say that if P is a symmetric property and it's declared between V and W, then it's also the other way around between W and V. And then we do something similar for transitive properties. We say that if P holds between U and V, and between V and W, then it must also hold between the start and the end, between U and W. So equivalent classes, the sixth rule for equivalent classes is similar to the rule that we had in the RDFS entailment rules. In RDFS, one of the first rules was that a class is also always a subclass of itself, and now we extend it by saying if V is equivalent to W, then V is a subclass of W and W is a subclass of V. So this is again used for the reasoning engine. We do the same for properties, that if P is the same property as Q, then Q is a subproperty, P is a subproperty of Q, and Q is a subproperty of P. And the nice notation for having functional properties is here that if P is a functional property, P holds between from X to P, X to V, and from X to W, then V and W are the same. The other way around also, you see the X is switched here and the V and W are switched here. So with an inverse functional property, we say that if V and W are related via the inverse functional property to X, then these V and W, they must be the same. So for example, they both have the ISBN number to X, and X is the same ISBN number, then that must mean that V and W, they refer to the same book. And then the last one that we'll discuss as an example is the property chain axiom, which we also we quite recently talked about. So we have this this notation saying R is can be derived from the property chain P and Q. So if P holds between V and W, and Q holds between W and X, then V and X, they get the real new relationship R. So for example, V has parent W and W has mother X, then that must mean that V has grandmother X. So this is the new knowledge that's being derived, this whole column. And there are lots of them, but we won't discuss them all, but the ones we discussed can get you going to have a very nice description of your domain. All right, thanks a lot. Thanks for listening, and good luck.